HarperCollins and Harper Audio present Lovecraft Country, a novel by Matt Ruff, performed by Kevin Kenerly.
Lovecraft Country. Jim Crow Mile, a unit of measurement peculiar to colored motorists, comprising both physical distance and random helpings of fear, paranoia, frustration, and outrage. Its amorphous nature makes exact travel times impossible to calculate, and its violence puts the traveler's good health and sanity constantly at hazard. The Safe Negro Travel Guide, Summer 1954 Edition. Atticus was almost home when the state trooper pulled him over. He'd left Jacksonville 2 days before in a secondhand 48 Cadillac coupe that he'd bought with the last of his army pay. The first day, he drove 450 miles, eating and drinking from a basket he packed in advance, stopping the car only to get gas. At one of the gas stops, the colored restroom was out of order, and when the attendant refused him the key to the whites' room, Atticus was forced to urinate in the bushes behind the station. He spent the night in Chattanooga. The Safe Negro Travel Guide had listings for 4 hotels and a motel, all in the same part of the city. Atticus chose the motel, which had an attached 24-hour diner. The price of the room, as promised by the guide, was $3. In the diner the next morning, he consulted a road atlas. He had another 600 miles to go to Chicago. Midway along his intended route was the city of Louisville, Kentucky, which, according to the guide, had a restaurant that would serve him lunch. Atticus considered it, but any inclination to further delay his homecoming was overwhelmed by a desire to put the South behind him. So after he finished breakfast, he got the basket from his car and had the diner cook fill it with sandwiches and Cokes and cold fried chicken. Around 1 p.m., he reached the Ohio River, which marked the border between Kentucky and Indiana. As he crossed the water on a bridge named for a dead slave owner, Atticus cocked his arm out the window and bade Jim Crow farewell with a raised middle finger. A white driver coming the other way saw the gesture and shouted something vile, but Atticus just laughed and stepped on the gas and so passed into the north. An hour later, along a stretch of farmland, the Cadillac blew a tire. Atticus wrestled the car to a safe stop at the roadside and got out to put on the spare, but the spare was flat too. He was frustrated by this. He checked the spare before setting out, and it had seemed fine then, but however much he frowned at it, the spare remained resolute in its flatness. A southern tire, Atticus thought. Jim Crow's revenge. Behind him, for at least 10 miles, there was nothing but fields and woods. But looking ahead on the road, he could see, perhaps 2 miles distant, a cluster of buildings. Taking the Safe Negro Travel Guide with him, he started walking. There was traffic on the road, and at first, as he walked, he tried waving down vehicles that were headed his way. But the drivers all either ignored him or sped up to get past him. And eventually, he gave up and just concentrated on putting one foot in front of the other. He came to the first of the buildings. The sign out front said Jansen's Auto Repair, and Atticus thought he might be in luck, until he saw the Confederate flag hanging above the garage entrance. That was almost enough to make him keep walking, but he decided he had to try. Inside the garage were 2 white men, a little fellow with a peach fuzz mustache who sat on a high stool reading a magazine, and a much bigger man who was bent under the open hood of a pickup truck. As Atticus entered, the little man looked up from his magazine and made a rude sucking sound between his teeth. "Excuse me," Atticus said. This got the attention of the big man. As he straightened up and turned around, Atticus saw he had a tattoo of what looked like a wolf's head on his forearm. "Sorry to disturb you," Atticus said, "but I've had some trouble. I need to buy a tire." The big man glared at him for a moment, then said flatly, "No." "I can see you're busy," said Atticus, as if that might be the problem. "I'm not asking you to change it for me. Just sell me the tire and I'll—" "No." "I don't understand." "You don't want my money? You don't have to do anything, just—" "No." The big man crossed his arms. "You need me to say it another 50 times? Because I will." And Atticus, fuming now, said, "That's a wolfhound tattoo, right? 27th Infantry Regiment." He fingered the service pin on his own lapel. "I was with the 24th Infantry. We fought alongside the 27th across most of Korea." "I wasn't in Korea," the big man said. "I was at Guadalcanal and Luzon, and there weren't any niggers there." With that, he bent under the truck hood again, his back both a dismissal and an invitation. leaving Atticus to decide which way he wanted to take it. The collective indignities of the past months in Florida made it a closer call than Atticus liked. The little man on the stool was still looking at him, and if he'd said anything, or even cracked a smile, Atticus would have gone in swinging. But the little man, perhaps sensing how quickly he could lose his teeth, even with the big man to protect him, did not smile or speak, and Atticus stalked off with his fists at his sides. Across the road was a general store, with a payphone on its front porch. Atticus looked in the guide and found a listing for a Negro-owned garage in Indianapolis, some 50 miles away. He placed the call and explained his predicament to the mechanic, who answered. The mechanic was sympathetic and agreed to come help him, but warned that it would be a while. "That's okay," Atticus said. "I'll be here." He hung up and noticed the old woman inside the general store watching him nervously through the screen door. Once again, he chose to turn and walk away. He went back to the car. In the trunk beside the useless spare was a cardboard box filled with battered paperbacks. Atticus selected a copy of Ray Bradbury's The Martian Chronicles. He sat in the Cadillac and read about the rocket summer of 1999, when winter snows were melted by the exhaust from a Mars-bound spacecraft. He imagined himself aboard, rising into the sky on a jet of fire, leaving North and South behind forever. 4 hours passed. He read all of the Martian Chronicles. He drank warm Coke and ate a sandwich, but mindful of the gaze of passing motorists, he did not touch the fried chicken. He perspired in the breezeless June heat. When his bladder could no longer be ignored, he waited for a lull in the traffic and went behind a sycamore that grew by the roadside. It was after 7 o'clock when the tow truck arrived. The driver, a gray-haired, light-skinned Negro, introduced himself as Earl Mabry. "Earl? Just Earl," he insisted, when Atticus tried to call him Mr. Mabry. He lifted the replacement tire from the rear of the tow truck. "Let's get you back on your way." With the two of them working together, it took less than 10 minutes. The simplicity of it and the thought of the afternoon just wasted for no good reason started Atticus fuming again. He stepped away from the car to compose himself, pretending to study the sun, now hanging low on the horizon. "How far do you have to go?" Earl asked him. "Chicago." Earl raised an eyebrow. "Tonight? Well, that was the plan." "Tell you what," Earl said. "I'm done for the day. Why don't you come home with me? Let my wife fix you a real dinner. Maybe rest a while." "No, sir, I couldn't." "Sure you could. It's on your way. And I wouldn't want you to leave Indiana thinking it's all bad people." Earl lived in the colored district, around Indiana Avenue, northwest of the state capitol building. His house was a narrow, wooden two-story with a tiny patch of grass out front. When they arrived, the sun had set and clouds were blowing in from the north, hastening the darkness. In the street, a stickball game was in progress, but now the mothers of the players were calling them inside. Earl and Atticus went inside, too. Earl's wife, Mavis, greeted Atticus warmly and showed him where he could wash up. Despite the welcome, Atticus was apprehensive sitting down at the kitchen table. For many of the obvious topics of dinner conversation, his service in Korea, his stay in Jacksonville, today's events, and most of all his father in Chicago, were things he didn't really care to talk about. But after they'd said grace, Earl surprised him by asking what he thought of the Martian Chronicles. "I saw you had it in the car." So they talked about Ray Bradbury and Robert Heinlein and Isaac Asimov, all of whom Earl liked, and L. Ron Hubbard, whom he didn't, and the Tom Swift series, which Earl had loved when he was young, but which embarrassed him now, both for the book's depiction of Negroes and for the fact that as a boy, he hadn't noticed it, despite his father's repeated attempts to point it out to him. "Yeah, my pop had some problems with my reading choices too," Atticus said. Mavis said little during the meal, seeming content to listen and to refill Atticus's plate whenever it was in danger of being emptied. By the time they finished dessert, it was full dark, and rain was drumming on the kitchen window. "Well," Mavis spoke up at last, "you can't drive any farther tonight in this." Atticus, past the point of even token resistance, allowed himself to be led upstairs to the spare bedroom. There on the dresser was a photograph of a young man in uniform. A black ribbon had been tied around the corner of the frame. "Our Dennis," Mavis said, or so Atticus thought. But as she began to put fresh sheets on the bed, she added, "He died in the forest." And Atticus realized she was talking about the Ardennes. Atticus lay in bed with a book Earl had offered him, more Bradbury, a short story collection called Dark Carnival. It was a nice gesture, but not really the best bedtime fare. After reading one story about a vampire family reunion and another very strange tale about a man who had his skeleton removed, Atticus shut the book, gazed for a moment at the Arkham House imprint on its spine, and set it aside. He reached for his trousers and got out the letter from his father. Reading it over again, he touched a finger to a word written near the bottom of the page. "Arkham," he whispered. The rain stopped at 3 a.m. Atticus opened his eyes in the silence, unsure at first what country he was in. He dressed in the dark and crept downstairs, thinking to leave a note, but Earl was awake, sitting at the kitchen table with a cigarette. "Sneaking out," Earl said to Atticus. "Yes, sir. I appreciate the hospitality, but I need to get home." Earl nodded and made a little shooing gesture with his cigarette hand. "Tell Mrs. Mabry, thank you for me. Tell her I say goodbye." Earl made the shooing gesture again. Atticus got in his car and drove off through the dark and still damp streets, feeling like the ghost in whose bed he had slept. By first light, he was well to the north. He passed a sign reading Chicago, 52. The state trooper was parked on the shoulder on the opposite side of the road. The trooper had been napping, and had Atticus come even 5 minutes earlier, he might have passed by unnoticed. But in the pink dawn light, the trooper sat up blinking and yawning. He saw Atticus driving by and came fully alert. Atticus watched in the rear view as the patrol car made a U-turn onto the road. He got the Cadillac's registration and bill of sale from the glove box and put them on the passenger seat along with his driver's license, everything in plain sight so there'd be no confusion about what he was reaching for. Lights flashed in the rear view and the police siren came on. Atticus pulled over, rolled down his window, and as he'd been taught to do in his very first driving lesson, gripped the top of the steering wheel with both hands. The trooper took his time getting out of the patrol car, stopping to stretch before ambling up alongside the Cadillac. "Is this your car?" he began. "Yes, sir," Atticus said. Without taking his hands off the wheel, he inclined his head towards the papers in the passenger seat. "Show me." Atticus handed him the documents. "Atticus Turner," the state trooper said, reading the name off his license. "You know why I stopped you?"
"No, sir,"
Atticus lied.
"You weren't speeding," the trooper assured him. "But when I saw your license plate, I got worried you might be lost. Florida's the other way."
Atticus gripped the wheel a little tighter.
"I'm going to Chicago, sir."
"What for?"
"Family. My dad needs me."
"But you live in Florida?"
"I've been working down in Jacksonville since I got out of the service."
The trooper yawned without bothering to cover his mouth.
"Been working or still working?"
"Sir?"
"Are you going back to Florida?"
"No, sir. I don't plan to."
"You don't plan to?
So you're staying in Chicago?"
"For a while."
"How long?"
"I don't know.
As long as my father needs me."
"And then what?"
"I don't know. I haven't decided."
"You haven't decided?"
The trooper frowned.
"But you're just passing through here, right?"
"Yes, sir," Atticus said, resisting the temptation to add, "if you will let me." Still frowning, the trooper shoved the documents back through the window. Atticus replaced them on the passenger seat.
"What's in there?"
the trooper asked next, pointing at the basket on the floor.
"What's left of my lunch from yesterday?" "What about in back? Anything in the trunk?"
"Just my clothes," Atticus said. "My army uniform, some books."
"What kind of books?"
"Science fiction, mostly."
"Science fiction? And this is your car?"
"Officer,
step out."
The trooper moved back from the door and placed a hand on the butt of his revolver. Atticus got out of the car, slowly. Standing, he was an inch taller than the trooper. His reward for his impertinence was to be spun around, shoved up against the Cadillac, and roughly frisked.
"All right," said the trooper. "Open the trunk."
The trooper pawed through Atticus's clothes first, patting down the sides of his duffel bag as if it too were a black man braced against a car. Then he turned to the books, dumping the box out into the trunk. Atticus tried not to care.
telling himself paperbacks were meant to be abused. But it was hard, like watching friends get knocked around. What's this? The trooper picked up a gift wrapped object.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.